next guest has quite a life story. Anne Summers has been pushing against barriers for a long time as a journalist, author, policy advisor and publisher. In 1975, her landmark book, Damned Whores and God's Police, was a bestseller, looking into the history of women in Australia. More recently, she was celebrated as an Australian legend on a stamp, and now her memoir has been published. It's called Unfettered and Alive. Let's welcome Anne Summers to Studio Tech.
Can I just say, my goodness, I love Damned Whores and God's Police. When I was at Teachers College, it was the purple-covered edition.
Right, that's right, with that even gorgeous just the painting on the front of them two girls.
Just the title alone deserves a Pulitzer Prize.
Thank you. I'm glad it's still going.
Yes. So when we look between then and now, what's the current state of Australia, of women in Australia?
Well, obviously things are a lot better. They'd want to be after 40 years, but there's still a lot of problems. I mean, we still don't get equal pay. It's like yesterday's figures showing that we get 23% less in many jobs than men do. We still have a shocking problem of violence in this country.
Yep.
61 women dead so far this year. It's only week 46. So, you know, there are really huge things that we have yet to address. But that doesn't mean we shouldn't be celebrating our victories and the fact that there's now more women in Parliament, you know, there's women leadership in a way that when I was growing up, you looked on the television, there was no women except the girl in a bikini doing the weather after the man read the news because women weren't allowed to read the news.
You, in fact, said you were born into a world that expected very little of women like you.
Exactly. We were meant to exist through our husbands and children, if at all, and as we got older, we were meant to just fade off, you know, fade to black, I guess. And now I think that women of my age and even older can lead full, interesting lives, as it should be.
You were in a unique position where Labor government invited you in to become a policy advisor and sort of sort some of the issues that were there for women. What did you find? Where were these bad decisions being made?
This was in 1992. Paul Keating invited me to come and work for him, and we did all this research all around Australia, focus groups, asking women what they thought their lives could be better with the government working in certain areas. And the results of the research were really unanimous. Everywhere around Australia, women said three things. They wanted government to do something on childcare, on women's health, and violence against women. So, I mean, all those years later, 24 years later, we still haven't really sorted the first and the third out. Women's health, I think we've done a lot more. We introduced breast cancer screening, ovarian cancer screening. We introduced a whole lot of things as a result of that research, which I think have made women's lives better. But we have a long way to go on childcare despite spending a lot of money on it.
What would you do? What would your solution for childcare?
Well, I would integrate childcare into the education system. So it'd be so that children's care starts at a very, very early age. We've already got the premises. You know, it would be much easier to do that than this hodgepodge we have at the moment.
Another big revolution that's taken place just recently is obviously the Me Too movement, which has really pulled the rug back on some appalling behaviours in the upper echelons of power. But this, it seems to have sort of, well, certainly a lot of people are saying it seems to have possibly even jumped the shark. Just recently we've seen potentially, you know, the allegations against Brett Kavanaugh sort of backfiring and serving as a cause when they weren't proven for the Republican base to come out and give Donald Trump and the Republicans a closer midterm result than a lot of people expected. We've just seen recently Four Corners do an expose on the what's happening at the top of the ABC, where suddenly out of nowhere there's an allegation of inappropriate touching because of a back rub that was given. How do you see the sort of future of the Me Too movement? And do you think there are areas where it has gone too far and that we need to be careful in what we're
saying? It's a long overdue reckoning whereby too many men in too many jobs thought that they could take advantage of their female co-workers or the women who work for them and either touch or, you know, demand favours or, you know, do things that simply they shouldn't be doing. And I think that women have copped this for a very long time, and now that they're speaking up against it and there is some justice being done, not enough in my... I don't think it's jumped the shark at all.
Right.
I mean, obviously each case needs to be investigated and you don't want to consign innocent men, but nor do you want all those women who put up with this for all these years to have to keep on putting up with it. So I think we need to find ways for these stories to come out and for the guys who've done this to stop, to apologise and to not do it again.
Were you confronted by incidents?
Occasionally.
And how did you deal with them?
Well, you know, I'm a fairly stroppy person and you know, I'd tell somebody to back off. But, you know, when I was working in the press gallery in Canberra, there were very few women in Parliament then. All the politicians were men, or virtually all of them. And some of those males, particularly some of the ministers, thought, you know, I was a senior journalist for the Financial Review. I got invited round to a minister's apartment one night to talk about policy. And we got there and the, you know, lights were low and the wine was open. And I thought, well, I bet Laurie Oakes doesn't have to put up with this.
Exactly.
Now, a story I really enjoyed from the book, The Little Excerpt, was the advantage of power dressing that you discovered. Was this when you were buying your own publishing company?
In New York, Sandra Yates and I were, we raised $20 million on Wall Street to buy Ms. and Sassy magazines.
Wow.
And Sandra said, look, people don't lend money to people who look like they need it. So we had to go out and buy these incredible outfits. It cost more money than I knew was possible to spend on a suit.
Look at those shoulder pads. That's magnificent.
But I wouldn't have knocked you back in those suits. No.
Well, Sandra said to me, I said, oh my God, we've spent all this money. She said, well, look, we're either going to raise this money or we'll be the best-dressed bag ladies in New York.
And it's an extraordinary turnaround from a time when, back in the 70s, where you couldn't even get a home loan because you were...
I know. I was the bureau chief for the Australian Financial Review newspaper in Canberra, working in Parliament House, earning a really good money, no debts, could not get a loan just because I was a woman.
Wow.
Just staggering.
Which shows what's changed. Are you full of hope? Do you feel, particularly in the corridors of power, in federal and state parliaments, that women's issues are getting prioritised as much as they need to, or is there still work to be done there?
There's still a lot to do. I mean, it's better than it was. It's a hell of a lot better than it was, and that's partly because there's more women in Parliament and they make sure those issues are raised. But we still have a long way to go to be treated seriously and to have our concerns part of the national conversation, not just shunted off to the side as, you know, women's issues.
Well, it's an extraordinary life, extraordinarily documented in this book. Anne Summers' memoir, Unfettered and Alive, is out now. Thank you so much for joining us.
It's been a pleasure. Thank you so much. Thank you.